Today is November 12th, 2013. We're here at the Special Collections Library of the University of Georgia talking to Judson Mitcham, who this week was inducted as the newest member of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame. And I'm very pleased to be able to sit here with Judson and talk to him, ask some questions about his work and his views. And Judson, thank you for being here.
Well, thank you, Hugh. It's a great honor to be here.
So first of all, I wanted to know from your own point of view what you see as the value of being a member of the Georgia Writers Hall of Fame, and what is the value of the recognition that Hall of Fame brings to a writer?
I'm not sure that the focus should be on the individual writer, but rather on the endeavor of writing, the act of writing, to give it value. I hate to sound like a curmudgeon, but I'm going to start off as a curmudgeon and continue to be one, I suppose.
That's fine.
When I pull up the University of Georgia, when I pull up the web and I see UGA, it's almost always about the football team. Now, I love the football team, but this university is so extraordinary. I would like to know sometimes, well, what else is going on there? What are the faculty doing? What kind of research is going on there? Anything that can point to the life of the mind, I think, is important. And the writer is at the center of that, I think, trying to pull together all the disciplines into some nugget that is can be lifted up and be transcendent in a certain way. So I would try to deflect attention from the individual writer toward the discipline of writing and say that the Hall of Fame itself is important. Now, as far as my own work, well, it was a surprise to me to be inducted into the Hall of Fame. And it was a wonderful event to have all my family here and my friends and to be able to make some remarks about what it means to me. I also have to say that awards are as wonderful as they are, and everybody wants it. They are secondary to any writer. The writer's work is what is primary. The best thing that would happen to me from this is that it would force me to write better and put some pressure on me and make me work harder than I have worked to do better work than the work that brought me into the Hall of Fame.
Well, I hope the pressure is not too overwhelming, but does the state of Georgia need a Writers' Hall of Fame?
Yeah, I guess I'm addressing it to the University of Georgia. I always sort of, yes, the state of Georgia. Do you mean separate from this?
Well, in general, I mean, should a state honor its writers, its literary heritage?
It's a curious thing. The state of Georgia, as many other states do, have the poet laureate position, which honors poetry. But there's no such position for the other genres, and I suppose that's just a matter of tradition. Anything that honors this life of the mind and this endeavor, I think, would be welcome. And I'm particularly interested in the work that is, there's no problem with being commercially successful and making money and being wildly popular and having celebrity, but work that is likely to endure, that is of quality, I think, does need to be recognized. We have other halls of fame and other sorts of recognitions that we all agree are important, and I think writing is no less than that.
You know, I should have said at the beginning that you are the Georgia Poet Laureate.
Yeah.
And exactly what does that entail?
Howard Nemiroff said when he was the U.S. Poet Laureate that apparently the primary job of the Poet Laureate is to answer the question, what does the Poet Laureate do? I think that it's an ill-defined, has been an ill-defined position, but now with the Georgia Council for the Arts and the leadership of Karen Patey, we have attempted to set forward some initiatives that promote poetry and poets in Georgia. The primary job of the Poet Laureate is to do just that, to promote the literary culture in the state and to go into various parts of the state and share poetry with people. I'm especially interested in bringing to the awareness of the citizens of the state how many excellent poets there are in Georgia, and there are so many. There were recently there was a Southern Poetry Anthology put together by William Wright, and there was an issue of the Southern Poetry Review that collected Georgia poets. You yourself have done a collection of Georgia poets for the University of Georgia Press a few years back. People are not aware of this, I think, and so I view the Georgia Poet Laureate's position as, yes, it's an honor, but really it's a position that should direct attention to the richness of poetry in the state.
You gave a very powerful reading of a series of your poems this past Sunday, and the theme, in one way or the other, of the poems of the reading seemed to be family. And you prominently featured poems about members of your family or dedicated to your family. In general, your poems actually cover a wide range of topics, but family always seems to be there at the center. And what are your thoughts about that?
Well, that's true. I return to, I seem to be fixated on Flannery O'Connor, on focusing on her over and over again, whether it's about poetry or fiction. Flannery O'Connor says that you can choose to write about anything you like, but you cannot choose what you can make live. And it appears to me that my family is what engages me emotionally, along with some other things, but when I find that I wish to preserve something or hold something and make language do some work that presents it in a special way, that is most often about my family. And most poets are poets of obsession. Most poets I like, I would say, are poets of obsession who write about the same thing over and over again. And so that has fallen to me. I had had a wonderful family when I was growing up, have a wonderful family now. I think those relationships are at the heart of everything. I don't think that, when Elizabeth Bishop, when Robert Lowell wrote poems drawing on his difficulties with Elizabeth Hardwick and used some of her anguished letters to him in his poems in The Dolphin, from his daughter and from his wife, and he shared them with Elizabeth Bishop, she scolded him severely and said, art is just not worth that much. I think there is a realm beyond art that art can draw on, but that cannot be violated by that art. And for me, that's always family, and I don't think I really have much of a choice in that. I've written some political poems, but they are less successful. I've written some poems that have philosophical ruminations. I've written some narrative poems that are completely out of the imagination, but it always seems to come back to family, and that seems to be the subject that has chosen me, so that's why they're there.
Well, my recollection is that some of your poems that I would regard as somewhat political and some of your poems that have deep philosophical musings also are family. poems or about your life.
Yes, yes. The poem that I read the other day, I don't know what you're thinking of, but the poem I read the other day that does both is when I went to the Georgia State Capitol to be sworn in as the Poet Laureate and took all my family. My little grandson Noah, when he came through the security, ran over to me, and I was standing by the statue of Alexander H. Stevens, who was, of course, famous for promoting the supremacy of the white race as the cornerstone of the Confederacy. And my grandson, who's always trying to see what he can move and what he can knock over, slammed into the pedestal of Alexander H. Stevens as if to knock it down. And that's the sort of situation that presents itself to me as, well, there's something. It involved both. And my problem with some of my poems that have to do with political is that the polemic overwhelms the poetry. And but I was fortunate to have that situation that I think summons both. And yes, it's once again a matter of what gives life to the work, and that family feeling somehow tends to allow me to take it to another level, I think. I hope so, anyway.
So when I first met you, your hair was very dark, and now it's very gray, and that's all to the point of saying you've reached a point in your career where you can look back over a period of decades as much as you can look forward. And I wonder how you regard your career in writing at this point in your life as compared to how you might have regarded it 30 years ago.
Hmm. When I began writing and I was struggling through trying to figure out what I was trying to do, because I had no formal education in writing, and still today I have those extraordinary gaps of the autodidact. But when I began, I was trying to find out what indeed the endeavor was that I was engaged in. It was at once more confusing and more exciting. Now I have some sense of what it is that I have been trying to do and what it is that I can do and what my limitations are and what the potentials still are. It's less important to me. Publication now is less important to me. The honors are less important to me. The producing of a work that is of quality is much more important to me. And this is not to say that I don't hurt when my work is rejected or that I don't wish to have an honor, but it's become much more internal for me, because I think I have learned what is really of value in the attempt to make a work that is of that will last and not just be held up for public recognition and acclaim. So to be known as a poet is one thing, but to be known as a poet or even to be given an award when the work that you have done is not as good as the work that you know you can do is not a particularly satisfying thing. So it's gone toward the work, and I'm happy with that.
I'm curious about your comment that you're an autodidact. Is that necessarily a disability?
I don't think it is. I suppose until recent days, all writers, I suppose, there were no creative writing programs, and people might have had university educations. No, I think it's something of an advantage, except when you're teaching writing, and one of your students knows much more about Wordsworth than you do, and you're trying to have a conversation with them, sometimes that falls. That makes for some difficulty when you're pontificating in the class and then they call you on it. But as far as creative writing goes, as far as fiction, poetry, To quote Howard Nemiroff again, I once heard him in a workshop say that the poem is a one-time filing system. It's a one-time filing system, so that you take from everywhere, file whatever you've got together, and try to make it come together as a work that does something. If you're drawing systematically from what you've been taught to value by means of creative writing classes or English classes, I think you're much less likely to have an original and an interesting juxtaposition of elements that might leap up to be something else. So the autodidact may not be a disadvantage, but I always feel it, you know, when I go into the English department somewhere.
You have spent your professional career as a professor of psychology, and you were head of your department for a number of years at Fort Valley State. And on the side, at least it seems to me that on the side you carried on this writing career, this writing vocation. What kinds of tensions or challenges did this create for you? And when I say tension, I don't necessarily mean a bad thing, but I'm very interested in that.
Well, I had to find a way to make them work together. So what I discovered was that I needed to find a way to make time to write when I knew that I had the energy to do so. So I got up early in the morning. Started getting up at 4:30, but I realized that's sort of pushing it. So I'd get up at 5 or 5:30 and write for an hour before my family got up. And I realized that if I tried to write for an hour, did the best I could, that I could then devote all my energies to the teaching of psychology and to the other activities that I had for the day. I was teaching a heavy load, and I was department head, and you know how that is. And it didn't leave any time during the day to really think about anything else. But what that day did, especially where I was teaching, was to present me with extraordinary events that I witnessed and didn't understand, and had to try to deal with, that eventually I found often came out in the work. So it was a rich environment for, I don't want to say material for poetry, that sounds so grasping, and but the subject matter of psychology itself tends to lend itself to the writing of fiction and poetry. I was a physiological psychologist in graduate school, but then I was teaching general psychology and all the subjects in this small department. The writing of fiction and poetry did not help me. I never did advance to full professor. Let's put it that way. You know how that system works, of publication within your field. But so it was sort of ancillary to academic advancement, the work that I was doing. But I feel fortunate to have done the work that I did in psychology with the people with whom I did it and where I did it.
Did your colleagues know you were a poet?
Eventually they did, and teased me about it quite a bit. But many, of course, appreciated it, and I did work with some of the creative writing classes informally at Fort Valley State. They were aware of it, but I was primarily the head of the psychology department.
So, to change the direction of our talk slightly, I want to ask you about the fact that your poetry and your two novels reflect, sometimes directly and sometimes indirectly, certain historical realities about the American South and the United States in the 20th as well as the 21st century. And where do you place yourself within those realities?
Somewhere near whatever treatment the poetry and the fiction gives it. Sounds like a dodge, but I don't mean for it to be. I don't find any way to, I don't find a way to address that in a better fashion than I have done by telling the stories. I guess I would say that I was a typical Southerner growing up in the, white Southerner growing up in, I was born in 1948. Civil Rights Act was passed in 64. Went to a segregated high school. Went from a segregated high school to a fairly segregated University of Georgia, and then went to Fort Valley State College to work not just with, but for African Americans. Which is an unusual thing, because the power differential is, the shift in power is something that not many people who grew up in the days of segregation have experienced to the degree that I experienced it. And I learned a lot by having to understand that power matters. Now, the power differential that I experienced was a benevolent one. I was treated wonderfully. People who viewed themselves as Christians, and as far as I can tell about what Christianity means, were, regardless of what theology and might be invoked here, they treated me like a child of theirs, and guided me and helped me, and treated me with love. You can see that it's very emotional to me when I think about this. So I feel fortunate to have been given that opportunity to change something about the way I grew up, sort of intuiting relations between the races. At the same time, I feel a great sense of, a great burden to do more with it, to try to bring some enlightenment. That sounds awful and pedantic and superior, but I do believe that we're in need of enlightenment. W.B. Du Bois, in his Double Consciousness, wrote in 1903 or so about how, imagine how it is for a black man and woman to the way you see yourself is, has had to be through the eyes of another. The double consciousness was, you saw yourself, but then you had to see yourself through white eyes. And I think what is still necessary for us all across this country is to reverse that. And for those of us who are white, to be able to see ourselves through the eyes of minorities, which we're still not able really to do. We think we've done that, but we haven't done that yet. And so creative work, novel or poetry, but perhaps especially the novel, that forces us to enter the lives of other people and perhaps see ourselves in ways that we were not able to see ourselves before, I think has some value. Literature, I suppose, is that may be the primary value of it, is it allows us to enter other lives and live those lives that are not ours, and to feel through those lives.
We seem to be at a point in our history, in our society's history, where seeing outside one's own point of view, one's own frame of reference, is increasingly rare. I mean, we're very fragmented and at odds with each other in a very unpleasant, hostile sometimes way. I mean, can you see your work as a poet, as a novelist, serving in some way to assuage that situation?
I would hope so. And everyone is resistant to that. It's a natural thing to be resistant to going outside our own consciousness, because we're afraid. we're always afraid, and I don't exclude myself from that, of the fear of going into the unfamiliar. But yes, isn't it interesting that you say we're increasingly, it appears, unable to do this, and that does seem to be at this point in our history true, that we're polarized and we're fragmented and we're certain and we're angry. And why should it be that way? Shouldn't we have moved in the other direction? So that may have to do with more of a sociological phenomenon or a political phenomenon, or I'm not sure. Things seem to me much more civil in the 1970s. You know how that was in the 60s and
yeah.
The radical that you were, as I
yeah.
In the 60s, and we had a sense of, I don't know if you were radical or not, but the sense that we had of what was right, and we were working for it, and the society was going to change, and things were going to be better. And then as we moved through the 70s, it appeared that some of these old backwards attitudes were gone. And then they weren't gone, and they came back with a vengeance, and they came back to, and they not only came back with a vengeance, they came back with a righteousness about them that seems to be persisting. And so I'm hopeful that that this is not that we're once again going to move back toward a broad consciousness of what it is to be human and not what it is to be Southern or white or black or Latino, but what it is to have a child who needs to be taken care of and loved and nurtured and educated, and just as somebody else's child needs that. All, yeah, I go back to the family.
Right.
But I really think that's at the heart of our value system. Is
well, given where we live, not just in the American South, not just in the United States, but given our place and time, and the some of the realities of history that you've discussed, what is a poet's obligation? And I apologize for the obtuseness of the question, but I'm really interested in your response. Does the poet have an obligation?
I don't know that the poet has an obligation. One thing that I have had to become increasingly aware of is I've taught poetry and dealt with the poems that come in to me from young people, is that there is not one poetry. There are many poetries. And the type of poetry that I prefer, that I write, is not the only type of poetry that has value. The language poets write work that I do not aspire to, but I would not say that it is of no value. It attempts to point out the limitations of language itself and to undercut itself. I don't aspire to that, but I do know that there can be a degree of accomplishment in that that is admirable. I don't aspire to write like John Ashbery. He's not an language poet, but I don't aspire to write poems that are essentially extremely smart, but never would move anyone to tears or very often to laughter. So I don't think the poet per se has an obligation to do anything other than make an interesting construction of language on the page that works as language on the page and does something in a fresh way. When I think about my own work, the work that that satisfies me is work that does more than play with language, but looks at something in the world and sort of holds it up to the light and turns it, and does so in a way that has a certain sonic value, that sings and is economical, and that doesn't waste time, and that is compact actually on the page. So I don't think the obligation of the poet is, you know, right after 9/11, I remember 9/11, and I was teaching up here for a semester when that happened. I wasn't on campus that day, but I was here shortly after and talked with UGA students. But on 9/11, I think, I don't know if it was Terry Gross or somebody was doing an interview with Billy Collins, and so they talked with Billy Collins. So we're talking with a poet on 9/11, which is fine, and he had good things to say, but I don't think the poet has anything to say about society immediately. That seems to be exactly the opposite of what the role of the poet is. The poet is to think about things at some length and to work to find some nugget of something that he or she can put into language that has some relevance to that. But I read on a blog a few days after 9/11, someone writing in italics and exclamation points and all caps, "Where are the poets? Where are the voices of the poets? The poets are silent." Well, instant poetry is not likely to be of much value. But what we did find out is, for example, in the next issue or two issues down of the New Yorker, the special 9/11 issue that they published, there was a poem by Adam Zagajewski. The title was "You Must Praise the Mutilated World." I may have the beginning of that wrong, but it had been written 18 months before 9/11, and it was a perfect poem for 9/11. So I think sometimes our task is not to create poetry, but to find the poetry that is already in the world that speaks to our condition, and that, of course, can go back many, 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 many years. So the obligation of the poet may be to not only write the poetry, but to search our entire history for poems that address our condition and point to it.
People are always talking about the state of the humanities. The humanities seems to have been in crisis for 50 years. You've been around for a number of decades. You've taught at a number of schools. You've been published widely. You know a lot of writers and poets, and you probably have a sense or a set of opinions about the state of the literary arts in the United States, and maybe in a larger context. And what is your sense of the literary world today?
I think the literary world today is an extremely rich world. I was on a panel last year addressing the question of, is poetry dead? And that question seems to come up over and over again. Is poetry dead? Why would poetry be dead? What could that possibly mean? I just wrote a poem yesterday. Was it stillborn? What can you mean? What they mean, I think, is that there's no market for it. People don't pay for it. A lot of people don't read it. But to me, it's akin to asking, is music dead? Well, how can music be dead? The humanities will always be with us as long as there are humans. It makes no sense not to have the humanities as long as we're humans. The humanities, I recall an essay written by, in Science magazine, the magazine of the Association of American Scientists, a lead article written by Northrop Frye back in the 70s in Science magazine, talking about the relation between science and the humanities. And he said something that has stayed with me ever since I read it, and that is that the humanities do not advance. They remain at square one. They never leave, and they deal with the eternal verities of birth, life, death, growth, love, hate. No one escapes those. The sciences advance, but the sciences must advance within the context of the humanities. And that seems to be something that we may have lost. I see, and I don't know what your experience is like with this. People are always trying to pull us away from the study of literature, or diminish the importance of the study of literature. The eternal question is, what can you do with an English degree? My answer to that is, well, you can live a rich life for the rest of your life. When you're driving from Atlanta to Tucson, Arizona, and you don't happen to have a radio or a CD player, you will not be bored, because you will have yourself, and you can talk to yourself and recall your life, and you can do so in ways that are interesting. You will have a rich internal life. I have very strong feelings about the values of the value of the humanities and the value of the arts. I have no illusions about that. I don't feel that the culture is moving in that direction. We're always moving in the direction of finding new ways to perhaps survive in more comfortable or entertaining ways. And I do think the humanities should be entertaining. I think the humanities should entertain in a profound way. And sometimes we forget that, and sometimes it's like, well, we're going for the profundity, but we're leaving out the entertainment. And so a great book should grab you right away and take you in. And the artist has that, the writer has that obligation to hold you, I think.
I make that point to my students that I think literature that we read, literature that's great literature, needs to be entertaining. And I think we often think of entertainment in the sense of loud explosions and car races and twerking, or whatever twerking. The term of the day is. But
I'm glad you brought up twerking.
Well, I just wanted to get that in. So, and I don't believe you've written any poems about that.
Not really sure. I sort of know what it is. But
where did you get your sense of language?
All my family, we've always been very, my father and mother were always very appreciative of wordplay, and I was raised in the Southern Baptist Church, where we studied the King James Bible all the time, and that is the most important influence on my writing, is the language of King James Bible. But I have to also say that we were a playful family, and to a certain extent a silly one. And my brother and I, whom I guess you met in the last couple of days, Ben and I, who are a year apart, were always, perhaps obnoxiously, mimicking people. And we did voices, and we did all kinds of voices, voices that I could do for you now, but it will not. We imitated local political figures. We imitated our relatives. We imitated one another. We did all kinds of voices and had fun with that. Both of us had a good Jimmy Carter imitation. And just the sort of relishing the sound of language, has been important for me, and very important for me when I began to write fiction and trying to write dialogue, to be able to hear what this person would have said and how this person would have said it. Because The Sweet Everlasting is written entirely in dialect of an old Southern white man that I had no trouble writing because I could hear it. It was my uncle. It was my uncle's voice, although he wasn't the character.
Right.
So a lot of places. And I was raised with, when I went to school, my teachers were very strict about correct grammar and pronunciation, and we were drilled and drilled, as I'm sure you were, in that. I'm not sure that's the case now, to the same extent.
What about your reading as a younger person, as a child, as a teenager? Did you read? Did this play into your sense of language?
Reading was not that important to me as a child. I was a reader, but I can't say that I read the classics or I remember sitting on the floor of the dining room when I was 8 or 9 reading Hiawatha and being really taken by that, and I remember reading various sports books, books about sports figures. As a young person, I was primarily involved in the playing of sports.
I wanted to pick up on your comment about the fact that you had been raised in the Baptist church. And when I listen to you read your poems, and when I just read them, I hear a very oracular quality. I mean, I hear the kinds of rhythms that I hear when a minister gives a sermon, at least some types of ministers. Is there a connection between your work and religion?
Oh, there definitely is. I don't consciously work for that rhythm, but I quite often I have tried to write in other styles, and I have put other rhythms on the page and worked and worked and worked to revise, and it almost always falls back to that same sound. And when I read, I've sort of surprised myself by going into that, and it seems to be reliably that. But yes, I think I think of this is not, I don't believe this is, I'm not proposing this for everyone. I don't think this is the only way to believe. I have great respect for people's beliefs. To me, the Bible is literature. That's what it is. The seriousness of those who wrote the Bible is the seriousness that I think we aspire to. People take the Bible as ultimate meaning, and what they're doing is they're taking great literature, attempting to deal with those things that are absolutely important, of ultimate importance to a human being, and putting that in words so that in the most powerful way it can be put, and we respond to it, and we repeat it, and we go back to it, and in the worst moments of our lives we look for it, in the best moments of our lives we look for it. Well, that's what great literature aspires to do. So I'm working on a poem right now called Scripture, which sort of just blatantly and pretentiously, I suppose, I hope not ultimately pretentious, but aspires to the sorts of meaning that one might find in the Beatitudes, for example, in Ecclesiastes, which to me is the great poem of human history. And I think that's not realized quite often, because the Bible is taken to be and may have been divinely inspired, but it may also have been the work of people who are looking on their lives in time and saying, given that we have this limited time here, what is important? What must we do? What must a human soul do and say? And that's what I think real literature that we value most does. That's what I think Flannery O'Connor does. She says, here's your time. Of course, she wouldn't agree with my ideas, my theology, but here's your time, and here's the way you can look at it, and here's what's valuable. And so I have so many thoughts about that.
Well, I don't know what your personal theology is, but when I read your poems, I often think these are religious poems. And how does that description appeal or not appeal to you?
I think they are. I find that, my chapbook, my first publication is Notes for Prayer in June, and then my first full-length book is somewhere in Ecclesiastes. And The Sweet Everlasting has some religious implication, and Sabbath Creek was my second novel, and the title of my prematurely selected poems is A Little Salvation. So I didn't work to have that, but when I settled on titles that seemed to work for me and to deal with the collection or the whole work, they seem to have religious implications. I am at heart a religious person, which I think goes back to family, goes back to where I was raised and how I was raised. And I do think that human life is a holiness. It may not be a transcendent holiness. It may not be a holiness in the way that holiness is usually thought of, but it's certainly of ultimate value. And to that extent, my writing is religious.
What kind of books do you read these days? And how do you choose what you read?
I'll read just about anything if the language is interesting. And I just read a book, I guess it won the National Book Award or Pulitzer, I can't remember which, by Jessamyn West, an African-American young woman who wrote Salvage the Bones. Yes, post-Katrina.
Right.
I thought that was a wonderful book. I read a lot of... I read the two newspapers a day. I read the Macon Telegraph and the New York Times. I read all the book reviews in the New York Times. Increasingly, or less and less, do I read the editorials in anything. I always read The New Yorker, I always read Harper's, I read The Atlantic, I read The Georgia Review and The Hudson Review and the Southern Review and The Kenyon Review. I read Poetry Magazine. I go into the library and pull, I have a Carol in the library at Mercer. I don't have an office, I have resisted an office. But I have a Carol there, and I work in the library, and then I allow myself a tour around through the stacks, and I pull volumes off at random, and sometimes check them out and take them into the Carol and read them, because it's a random selection and it draws my interest. Now, when I'm working on something, and I'm working on a novel now that I can't talk about without losing energy for it. But I'm reading a lot of work now on, I just read Nell Irvin Painter's book, The History of White People, which I thought was an extraordinary work. I learned a lot from that. I just read, again, Leon Littwack's The Trouble in Mind, History of Blacks in the Jim Crow South. Books in that vein, and novels. And I'm always reading poetry. Always reading poetry and poetry criticism. I have almost all of the University of Michigan series Poets on Poetry, so I read a lot about the craft of poetry. I read novels and study them for the way they are structured, but I only read them really if they're entertaining. If they really have to hold me, I just can't read a novel for another reason. Recently I haven't read all of Philip Roth, but I've been reading the late Philip Roth, later work of Philip Roth. And right now I'm reading a biographical treatment of Philip Roth by Claudia Roth Pierpoint, no relation, about his work. So I jump around and I read whatever strikes me as interesting. A few months ago, I read this book about the history of Scientology, which I found interesting and sort of sensational. So I like sensational things. I don't read much, I don't know if you would call it genre. I don't read crime novels, but I know very good writers who do, and they read thrillers and mysteries. So hard to characterize exactly. It's all over the place.
When you read, are you reading the physical books? Have you made any kind of progress towards reading books on a tablet?
I've resisted it, but that's coming, isn't it? I like the physical book. I prefer, and in fact, the physical character of the book is very important to me. I guess I'm a bit neurotic in this regard. I almost never want to have a hardback, although I will buy them if I have to, because I like the texture of the paperback. I like being able to fold the paperback back. I like being able to hold it. I like being able to put my little sticky notes all over it. And I never read a book with a dust cover on it because it's physically unpleasant to me. And so I have to store those away and read the hardback with the bare hardback if I have that. I don't respond well to my own work. I can't copy edit my own work if it's on the screen. I can't really see the errors in it. I read over things. Only when I print it out can I see, oh, there's a problem there, or I missed that. But gosh, it's wonderful to have a device wherein you can just download a novel and put many novels in it. I don't have it yet, but I know I'm going to have it.
How does it make you feel to know that, to anticipate the possibility that people will be reading your poetry or reading Sabbath Creek on a tablet or on a computer screen as opposed to in the physical form?
I don't think it's I think the art of the book, the actual book itself, that would be very sad if we lost what the bookmakers do. So I, as long as that's not completely lost, it doesn't bother me at all that anybody would read the book on a tablet. But some of the art, some of the designs of books are really extraordinary, and it's not something that one would want to lose. I think.
This is an odd question, perhaps, but do you write for the ages? Do you write for readers who will be reading you after you're gone? Do you think of literary fame or immortality? Or I know those things are kind of forms of ambition, I guess, but are those in your head?
No. I write, I find it necessary to write mainly for, first for, to entertain and move myself. And to have a very severe and honest assessment of my own work after I have put it away and come back to it and looked at it and tried to see, well, does that, how do I feel about that? Is that working? So that's the first criterion. And then if others read it, and it's almost never, the writer can be completely certain about what the value of the work and give it to somebody else and they don't see it at all. And so I think we all have to be open to restructuring and to reworking what it is that we've done. But it doesn't make much sense to, in fact, I think it's probably counterproductive to think about any matter of fame or certainly immortality or anything of that nature. I do aspire to, I've said this before, that in writing poems, if I had one aspiration, it would be to write one great poem about 15 lines long on the order of Robert Hayden's Those Winter Sundays. If I could write one poem that was as good as that, that would have the staying power of that poem, that would be good. But one can't aspire to greatness before one aspires to being good. It's got to be good first. So you've got to go through good to get to that. So to be thinking about great is not hasn't been helpful to me.
What would be your advice to a younger person who had a serious ambition to be a writer?
I would say read widely and deeply and imitate. We often say in the classroom, steal. T.S. Eliot said, you steal, because he did. which is not to say take the words, but to take the essence of what they've done. Imitate, I would say. Read those poets and writers whose work you love and read them again and again and study the craft of how they have done, what they have done. Try to see how they moved, how the work grew within the work. I think don't be in a hurry to publish. Write in private without showing your work to anyone. Make a pact with yourself that you will show your work to no one. Of course, eventually you will break that pact and you will show it to someone. But if you don't have that absolute promise to yourself that you are completely free to put on the page whatever you wish to put on the page, your mother's not looking over your shoulder, nobody's looking over your shoulder, then you're less free. This is a problem with the model of the writing workshop. People write it and they know it's going to be read by the workshop next week. So the workshop is always over the shoulder of the writer in that context. I teach those workshops, so I know how that goes. So write in private. Don't be concerned with being being seen as a writer, but rather with being a writer. I said in one of my, somebody asked me a question similar to this, and my smart ass answer was don't be a writer who wants to write so he can wear a Greek fisherman's cap and go to the party. You know, that don't be that person. To pose, to be seen. And I think ultimately, I would say, be serious. Even if your seriousness is the form of comedy or humor, be serious about it, about your craft. Work on your craft, and try to be honest about the value of it. Try to be honest about who you are and what you can do and what your abilities are. And it's also true. I think the thing with the developing writer is, at some point, you have to understand whether or not the writing itself is giving you pleasure. If when you sit down to write, if you sit down to write and you look up 2 hours later and you've been so completely involved in this that you have lost time, then you may be in something that is worth pursuing. And that's, of course, not just creative writing. That happens to any sort of intellectual endeavor in which you can be immersed and lose yourself. So I'd say find that spot that where you sort of disappear into the other that you're trying to clarify and travel within and move within. That would be my advice. I have a lot of other advice, but I'll stop with that.
Thank you, Judson. I've enjoyed talking with you. Appreciate your thoughts and your ideas and your poetry and your novels.
Thanks, Hugh. I'd like to interview you sometime.
Well,
that's not going to happen, though. Well, thank you.